Wow, I didn't do my exercises, all of them, this morning. How about you? How about you? But I did do a lot of balance exercises this morning. That's what I started out with, actually. This is a big change. Started right straight out of bed, getting on that foam roller. Like a foam roller is like this. Okay, it's a foam roller. So I stand on something like this and practice balancing. So I did a lot of that this morning, a lot of it yesterday, and then I did do some stretching, not as much as normal, but some. So I did what's essential right off the bat, and so this is advice that we'd like to, whoops, follow. Adjusting the light levels. Okay. Right off the bat, do what's essential first. Okay, take care of that. Now, before I even got out of bed, I did about 4 hours of intense, it could be, I don't know, I didn't keep track, but hours of intense meditation. So I did what's essential first, the meditation first, then the balance exercising. Those are the two essentials that we have to do. You cannot, everything else has to take it, get in line behind that. Still adjusting the light here, which is good. This is going to get too much here, so let me see. Boom. Do what's essential first. Do what's essential first. So this morning's meditation was extremely profound. Extremely profound. Extremely profound. Extremely profound, and I had to wow it like as much as I've ever wowed anything. So I've spent so much time already this today wowing, 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 wowing. I can't get the light right, but that's okay. Just wow it. It's already, everything is already wowed. Everything is already wowed. Ultimately, I use that. Everything is already wowed. This too is wow. Whatever arises in the mind. Now, as Ramana Maharshi says, the intelligent mind examines itself. Very true. I have an intelligent mind. Always have. So, what I've spent my life examining my mind. I say, what is my mind up to? What's really going on here? It's very odd, the mind. And so today, I did intense examination because I had this breakthrough, and then I wowed it, and I tried to keep wowing it, and I saw all the different tactics the mind uses, so many different tactics to lose sight of the wow and lose sight of the breakthrough, the vision that I had. And I kept saying no, and bringing back to the wow. Just said, okay, no, wow, just wow, already wow, that's already wow. Everything. So I was able to do it, but constantly the mind is coming up with more clever strategies. It's very daunting, really. I mean, meditation is it's like trying to keep your balance on a some tricky roller, actually. So the balance exercises I find have a very strong correlation to meditation, very strong correlation. That's why throughout history, the monasteries and various ashrams and retreats and temples, etc., there'd be physical exercises, and like a lot of them were like balance exercises, like Tai Chi, for instance. They developed, ways of moving, and so, but we don't have to formalize or institutionalize it to that extent right now in a do your own thing world. You can do it your own way. Like I just use a foam roller. And it works great. And I want to keep my balance like John, Florence, just it never fall. The turbulence just, and so guess what? I'm getting better. Just like that, I'm getting better. Because when I fall, I said, wait a minute, John wouldn't have fallen off that. What are you doing? Okay, so I, oh. And what I found out is as soon as I fixate in some way, the fall begins. But if I keep moving my the parameters I have, There are a number of them. The shoulders, the ankles, the knees in and out, are together and apart. The hips turning, moving forward, moving backwards, lifting the weight off one leg, lifting the weight off the other, going towards the back, going towards the front, going forwards, going in the rear direction. All these parameters, crouching a little bit. If I keep just actually doing that on purpose, instead of reacting to being out of balance, I find that I'd stay in balance. It's amazing. And this is what kids do naturally. Is that their minds don't fixate so much. At least the ones who have great balance, you see, like cats, they're amazing. They're not saying, okay, this is how I have to do it, I need to do this. They're just allowing their body to move like this. And the parameters are all there. And I got it. Yeah, it's just like, oh, gosh. Before, I'm on the roller, and then I'm waiting to lose my balance, and then I'm reacting to the loss of balance. Like, oops, I'm going backward. I'm going towards the backwards. I need to go forwards, you know, like that. But now, instead of doing that, I'm intentionally going backwards a little bit, and then forwards, and then to this, the front side, and then the rear side. And lifting my weight and turning my shoulders, and my arms are moving. And so I'm intentionally moving instead of trying to fixate and freeze myself into some static balance state. So in meditation, we use 360-degree wow. 360-degree wow. Not fixated wow in this direction, or fixated wow in that direction. It's like you feel that there's flexibility in every direction. It's just 360-degree wow right now. 360-degree wow right now. So in the last couple of days, ever since I adopted that convention of John Florence, I have made great progress in my balance. It's just like a revelation. Because I was willing to say, hey, you know what? I need to get better. There's someone way better than me. I'm seeing what he can do. And so, you know, I'm deficient in balance. You know, so what do I need to do to get better at it? So if you see somebody who has tremendous balance, you realize it's possible. It's possible. So there, you know, it must be doing something right. And you see the guys that fixate, muscularly fixate, easy to push them off balance. These are like the Tai Chi masters and the what do they call this? The martial arts masters, in terms of they can just come up to you like this and just touch you, and you just fall over backwards. Because they see where you're fixated. They're unfixated. See, it's a meditational practice to remain unfixated. But, however, meditation is even more profound than physical practicing. However, since we're so physical in today's world, I certainly advise if you are active, or you know, the world's so active now that you should start practicing your balancing, your flexibility, balance, agility, strength. But balance is the most important, because that brings everything shows up in your balance, actually. So if your core is really strong, you find the balancing is much easier. These young people are so strong. Like when you're 18, 19, right? And your whole life has been like surfing or something. I mean, you're just so lean and strong. Your core, everything, and so that's part of it. So in an active world as we are now, you will be called to action. We're in a time of action. It's going to be a phase of action in the world. Okay. Maybe unprecedented action, activism, action. Okay, so you're going to be pulled into action in some way. However, you can block that by your activity being balance practicing. So what I'm really into is practicing balance. Okay, so that's your action. But this balance training has a very strong correlation. It's a one-way correlation. It doesn't go in both directions, but it has a strong correlation to meditation. So when you're focused on balancing and as your action, you won't get pulled away from your meditation so easily. This is why throughout history, like in the East, they had the martial arts, they had this various training. Part of it was just exactly this, is to deal with the action aspect here, so you don't get pulled away from the meditational aspect. So this is really important. The Holy Spirit, grace of God, the Dharma Kings, emphasizing this to me. This started with Christmas. Say, okay, you know, balance is where it's at. And, you know, it's not easy, balance. It's very humbling, which is great. It's very humbling because you're up there saying, oh, I got my balance, and suddenly, whoa, I just lost it. And what happened? So, you know, instant failure, kind of like that. Just like in meditation, you're right in the wow. You're wowing it, wow, 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 and suddenly you realize, wait, whoa, I lost my wow. What happened to it? I put it into time. I put it in, there's all these little tricks. I put it into contrast. Suddenly you feel fogged over, right? And say, okay, well, that fogginess is already totally wow. It's already totally wow. And then you're back in the wow. So in other words, you regain your mental balance. So the physical practicing balance is very similar to meditation, practicing the wow and staying balanced in that, in the wow, okay, which prevents panic from happening. If we panic, we fixate. If we fixate, we end up either going towards brutality or towards mental illness. Two sides of the same coin of dysfunctionality. So I had to block panic this morning very, very intensely. It was the most intense I've ever experienced it, actually. And I prayed to Jesus for last night because it was his day, Christmas. I said, Jesus, I haven't heard from you in a long time. I know you're there, but could you give me a gift for Christmas? And so this morning I got this gift. And I had to, you know, wow it big time, big time. And then I saw just how the mind tries to get away from that. Oh, so much cleverness, huh, the mind. And yet, meditation is just to keep on trying to keep your balance. And you know, I want to keep my meditational balance like Rama Maharshi. I want to be like Rama Maharshi. So like the action balance is, I want to be like John Florence. It's just, you know, the waves just hit me and I just don't go down, you know. And then meditationally, I want to be like Rama Maharshi. So this is humility. You're saying, hey, I'm not there yet at all. There those are way better, and I want to be their protege. I want to study them, be their understudy like that. I want to do it like they do it. It's very, very helpful like that to have conventions like this that blocks everything else out. You already have a path, you already have a focus, you're already a protege, you already know who you're studying with, you know, this kind of thing. And then, so all the other action passes you by because you're already focused on what you need to be focused on, and you know it's right. Certainly the wow is right. And keeping your balance in the wow. What a morning I had working on that. What an astonishing workout session. Very humbling because the mind just kept coming back with some new trick. And I just had to keep my poise and just went, go straight right back to the wow. Saying, just know, already, that's already totally wow. Totally wowish. Already totally wow. 360 degree wow. Now, this practice works. It's very similar to Ramana's self-inquiry, which I understand now. He just says, who is the I? Where's the I in this? Where is the I? Now, this is not a question. It's a technique. He's not like saying, ask yourself, where's the I, and try to find the answer. No, just state this as your position. Like, well, no matter what arises in your mind, just say, well, where's the I? Where's the I? Where's the I? So I don't care what arises. Where is the I? Just keep stating that. Where's the I? And in Zen, you would have a koan, like, you know, where's the sound of one hand clapping? What's the sound of one hand clapping? Whatever arises in your mind, you just apply the koan to it. It's all the same principle here. The wow, the koan, who is the I, where is the I, and the wow, 360-degree wow. It's all the exact same principle. It blocks everything else and you keep your balance just in this one 360-degree way. And where's the I? So the mind is on some tangent, and you say, where's the I? Where's the I? So Ramana says this is the fastest way, and I'm seeing now. I see what he's talking about. The Zen way, the Wow way, the I inquiry way, those are all very fast ways, but necessary ways. We need to get into that for sure. You might say they're very effective, necessarily effective to reach the goal that we're after. Now, if we don't want to reach the goal we're after, then we won't do these, but we will continue. We'll be swept away by all the tricks of the mind and just be like foam on the ocean, just being pushed around by the ocean like foam. But if we see that all the foam is already totally wow, the whole ocean is all totally wow, the sky is totally wow, everything is just totally wow, already totally wow. There's no storyline at all. All storylines have already ended in the wow. 360 degree in the wow. If we take this approach, we're going towards something. And I saw it today. I experienced it. I experienced it this morning. I have to be sure I'm calmed down enough to even address it here, because I don't want to try and label it, you know, or describe it. But certainly what the Dharma kings have told us is accurate. The mind, I took one little step, and the instant I took that little step, my mind suddenly was completely smoothed out. This is a way of putting it. Completely smoothed out. Image-wise, it was like I just saw this like an ocean and like land that was just absolutely smooth, and it just went on forever. Perception-wise, the imagery in my mind was like, oh, it's just like the smooth concrete for the land and the smooth water and the smooth sky, and everything was perfectly smooth in all directions. And then I said, wow. Okay, so this is what took place. And then I realized, hey, I have to wow this. And so then the battle wasn't over. You know, what was that step that I took? The battle is the wow, is to not allow all these storylines to arise. All this background story. I said, no, it's already wow. It's already wow. Everything's already wow. So when the better you get at wowing or inquiry or koaning, this experience will arise for you at some point, because then you can handle it. You can block the panic. But it's not likely to arise for you otherwise. You can try to force it with drugs, but it's not the same experience at all. And that causes severe problems, because you won't know how to wow it. And then you'll really go off on all sorts of crazy fixations, actually. That's why drugs are a big no-no. They can alter perception in all sorts of different ways. But this is totally different. This was totally gentle. Perfectly gentle. Perfectly gentle. And I saw just how it, just like that. Just like that. Everything was smooth. Complete smoothness just arose as the condition of my mind. In the completely gentle way and smooth way. Smooth, gentle, graceful, gentle glory. Just immediately upon this one little step I took. And immediately then I said, okay, wow. This is something I've never experienced. So it's going to wow me for sure. It's going to send shock waves through me. And it certainly did. And it's continuing to. But, so my task is take it in stride. But it took several hours of intense meditation, intense wowing, until it, you know, calm down a little bit. Then I had to get up out of bed. And you might think, well, do you have to be in some yogic posture for all this and something? Well, you can or you not. Almost all the time I meditate is when I wake up early in the morning and I'm just lying in bed. So I'm not even aware of my body, really, because the body's just lying there in bed. So that works really well. Some yogic posture might work well, but, you know, historically, I guess many have done that. It works for me just lying in bed. You know, 5 a.m, everything's quiet, everything's dark, you're just lying in bed. And so you're able to really focus in on the mind without any distractions, which is what's important. That's why people meditate in caves. They just sit there, maybe, and they forget about their body, they forget about the outside world, they forget about the cave, they forget about, and they're, what are they doing? They're just paying attention to their mind and trying to, working on holding on to that already there-ness. And dismissing, you know, how to keep the attention on that already there-ness. Let the attention settle on the already there-ness. Now, some will meditate, some won't. Some, there's those that do, and there are those that don't. And that's it. There's nothing anyone can do about that. There's some, those that don't want something to get a hold, you know, something, you know, like a prize. Okay, well, they win a prize. And then those that do, they meditate. Like this. Wow. So this is a different type of meditation than trying to attain something, really, aiming at attainment. See, this is first, we're committed to this balance practice, mental balance of as far as staying in the wow, and we're strong at this. And then, because of this confidence, we take this little step and, wow, that result, it solves that, settles everything. And then we wow it. Without the confidence in being able to wow our experiencing, we will try to manufacture something, okay? And that is not right. Don't try to manufacture or engineer presence. It's already there. We just let our attention settle on it, but this will shock us for sure. So what do you do with the shock? Then you have to, let the mind settle down. You don't want to get fixated on any of those storylines that arise. The mind will throw all these storylines of what's prior to already there-ness. And if you get fixated on any of those, then you're still thinking you need to do something. You're still searching for presence. You need to manufacture. You're back in manufacturing again. It's interesting, in my life, I've never been interested in making stuff, manufacturing anything. I couldn't make a machine to save my life. You know, coding, software thing. I have no interest. I have no interest in machines. I have no interest in building anything. I've never had any interest in building anything. I really don't have any interest in doing anything. People say, well, what are you going to do with your life? I said, I'm going to not do my life. I'm interested in not doing a life. Well, you need to have a successful life. No, I'm interested in not having a life. At all. Did Rama Maharshi have a life? No, he didn't. No, he did not. He had no life. Didn't have any life at all. He was life. He is life. He doesn't have a life. He is life. Who has a life? What is it that's having a life? That's the delusion. So I may be able to talk like this and laugh and, be confident, humble swagger and all that. But this comes from the intense meditation of balance work, the wow work. I wasn't feeling like this a couple hours ago. A couple hours ago, I was sweating it. I was holding on for dear life, I said, well, I don't want a life. All these life stories keep arising to me. I said, no, I'm already, there's already 360 degree wow. That's all there already is. So it's the work that we put in that's all important. There are those that do and those that don't. Such an active time in the world that people think that they might be able to find a successful life. This is the trouble, isn't it? With all this technology, people are swept away into my smartphone might be able to tell me how to have a successful life. Hey, Siri, how do I have a successful life? It says, go down to the local store. There's sales down there. I have 50% off the new iPhone. That is how you have a successful life. Oh, thank you, Siri. Okay. I go, there's a sale somewhere. And now, I don't have a life. I only have 360 degree wow. There's only 360 degree wow. I don't even have it. That's all there is. There's no I having it. This is the experiencing. This is experience experiencing itself. So the worst thing anyone can do is to try to have a life. That's death. What you're really trying to do is have a death. We're trying to advance death. That's what existence is all about, is trying to evolve death. We're trying to evolve this consciousness called death. There is no such consciousness. There never has been. There's no death consciousness, actually. We're pretending, we're working on it, so we assume it's there, but it's not there at all, actually. So I'm a very sober person, a very serious, I say, I'm not the life of the party because I'm holding on for dear life here. This clarity arises this morning. This is extraordinarily profound. I recognize the value of it, the profundity of it right away. I just said, oh my gosh. Okay, wow. Go to work. Right away, go to work and block the panic. Go to work. In other words, my faith at this little, just one little step is all it takes. I had faith in it. I took it. The results instantly were there. So now what I have to do? Wow it. That's it. I did not think, what did I do? No, I knew what I was doing. So in other words, I'm already aware of what to do, but it's the shock of it that I have to go to work on. That's what we have to go to work on. We know what to do. Our mind knows what to do. don't worry about that. So people are asking questions, what do I do? Those are the ones that are not doers. Those that do and those that don't. The ones that don't are asking, what do I do? The ones that do, they're doing it. They're blocking the panic. That's all there is to do. So if you're a doer, you will know what you need to do. If you're not a doer, you're always asking questions, what do I do? You spend your whole life asking questions, what do I do? I don't know what to do. I don't know what to do. And then you believe that you die, because that's what you want to do. You want to die, because we're trying to have a new creation greater than God. Separate creation. Trying to evolve death. So those who keep asking, I don't know what to do, I don't know what to do. What they're really saying is, death is what I want to do. 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 That's why I'm having a life, so this life can die. All right? Beautiful, crystal clear day here in California. I wish there were some clouds moving around. That'd be nice. Kind of like some cloudiness during the winter to see some stuff, but it's not a cloud in the sky. Yeah, it's about 54 degrees or something today. I'll probably get to 54. Still, very still. Chilly, though. I mean, there's been rain, so there's moisture in the air. Enough moisture in the air for it to be chilly. But cool, let's say, very quite cool feeling. But for December 26, it's just a gorgeous day. That's for sure. My knee is feeling better. It's feeling better. I forgot to put heat on it this morning. What am I doing? What am I thinking? Okay. But it's feeling better. I did some deep knee bends. Kind of not half. I didn't go all the way down. That hurts a little too much. But 3/4 of the way down and up. I did 10 of those. And it felt okay. So it's improving day by day. It's improving day by day. There's still... Let me see. That's better. It's better. I hit my knee. I don't feel any pain. That's great. Wow. You see, I think what has happened with me, when I was getting so agile, I was starting to pursue storylines too much. Like, hey, I could do this. Hey, I could do this. And I was sort of neglecting my meditation. So maybe that's why the knee blew up on me. I did it on purpose. Slow me down. Get back to the meditation. Because this is what I'm really good at. There are not many in the world that are good at meditation. Really, I'm like a near expert at it. That's why Longchenpa calls me a Dharma prince. I'm not a king. I'm a prince. But a prince is, princes means you're really good at what you do. And he's talking about meditation here. Real Dharma king meditation. So. That's, it's valuable to be really good at meditation. Very valuable. This is the skill the Dharma kings are looking for. And Ramana this morning said, trust it. I was saying, Ramana, when is my vacation? I need like 10 days in a whirlpool, And I really need my, it's swimming. I want to swim and spend time swimming and whirlpool and really get revitalized for this, for what's to come. I need that. I really need it. I'm so stressed out because I work so hard at my job. It's so tiring driving through Silicon Valley traffic all day. That's like one of the worst jobs in the world as far as stress goes. It's just like 360-degree worry. Because what is somebody going to do? Because most people have never driven here before. It's questionable if they even know how to drive, and they just are apt to do anything at any moment. That's no fun. At least like in India, everybody are used to that. Everybody does anything at any moment. But here we all have rules and laws and regulations and conventions that we follow, and people are just not following them anymore. So it's just so crazy. We're all having almost nervous breakdowns. Everyone you talk to says, God, traffic is just killing me. You know, it's just horrible. Just horrible. You never know when you're going to run into just absolute traffic jams that delay you for 30 minutes. Yeah, you never know. Just around the next bend, 30-minute delay could just pop up like that. And then, of course, everybody's on their GPS and they're saying, oh, there's a delay there. So what do? They get rerouted. And then that becomes the bottleneck because you get all these tech geeks thinking they're going to miss the accident. They all go on side streets and those like going to gridlock. So you get double gridlock everywhere. One of these days, like going past the accident is going to be the fast lane because everybody else is going to be like detoured around it on the side streets and then they just won't be moving at all. Yeah, it's true. It's true. Go where the accidents are. Nobody will be there. Because they all think that they're outsmarting it by listening to their smartphones. As if they lost their intuition, right? You see how that goes? When you go with the herd, you always end up in gridlock, don't you? Yeah, I mean, there's a freeway that goes through our town, and it gets gridlocked so badly, and so everybody was taking surface streets through our town and completely gridlocking that up too. So they've tried to do all sorts of things to prevent that, but the traffic's just abominable because everyone's now going on side streets trying to find a way around the freeway gridlock. So everything is gridlocking. And maybe someday the freeway will be wide open. Yeah. Don't bet against it, actually. There's the herd mentality always overlooks, you know, what really works. They're always say, wait a minute, you know, this, I'm still in a herd, you know. Being herded towards death, trying to evolve death, trying to evolve it. The evolution of death, it should be called. It's not the evolution of consciousness, it's the evolution of death, except nothing's ever been born. So it's kind of hard to have death if nothing's ever born. So we keep imagining we've been born, that we have a life. Imagining we have a life is the central delusion. We don't have a life, we are life. There's only life. There's nothing other than life. There's only eternal life everywhere. There's no such thing as no life. It's everything is life. There's just one life. That's it. There used to be a lot more people meditating than there are now. Okay, because of technology, everybody thinks they don't need to meditate. All they need to do is Google something. They Google meditation. I mean, Google meditation. Okay, now I know what meditation is. I just did it. I Googled it. That's their definition of doing, is to Google something. Or, you know, smartphone text. They text, hey, meditation. Hey, there's a picture of a meditator with this Facebook meditator. Meditation. Onto Facebook. Like, click. I did it. I did it. I got with the program. I got with my life. I have a life now. I just shared a meditation picture on Facebook. I have a life now. Everybody's trying to have a life. No, we're trying to not have a life. And in fact, we already don't have a life. We never have had a life. And you see that, it's just, wow. Everything's completely smoothed out, completely smooth. Smooth mind, it's always been that way. I've just been frantically trying to make it some other way. But we can't change the nature of the mind. We can't change the fact that all is life. That's all there is life. All there is eternal life. There's nothing else. There's nowhere to take a birth. Well, how can life be born? There's nowhere to be born. It's everywhere already. Yeah, if you get a drone, you'll really have a life, you know? Like the people say, yeah, that's the way to really have a life. I gotta get a drone. flying around. Now I have a life. But we're supposed to be meditating, right? On, I can't have a life because there's only one life, and it's everything, everywhere. There's nowhere where it's not. As the gurus say, Dharma kings, I can't even turn around. He said, where can I go? I'm everywhere already. There's no place I can go. There's no place I can leave and go to somewhere else. I'm everywhere. That's Sri Srinanda, my mother, queen of WOW. They asked her, why are you going there? She says, going where? I'm everywhere already. I'm already everywhere. There's nowhere I can go. I can't even turn around. There's nowhere to turn around. See, everything is, in other words, that's the standpoint of eternal life. That's a speaking from, the Dharma kings speak from this, the one perspective, and there is no other, of eternal life. All is eternal life, everywhere, already. Already WOW. There's just this already WOW. So our perception, reaction, conceptualization, definition, everything, just WOW. It's already WOW. It's just WOW. Everything's already WOW. All storylines, already totally WOW. All storylines, already totally WOW. Whatever arises in your mind, it's already totally WOW. Now, again, this is, Ramana assured me back in about the year 2000 in a dream. He says, look, you keep doing what you're going to do. He says, that's just as effective as what I, you know, my inquiry. It's just as effective. So it's just a little different style, stylistically wise, but it's just as effective. It's the exact same principle. So he said, I want you to do it that way. Okay, don't try to copy me in terms of just, I must do the I inquiry. He says, that's already going on. That's fine. But he said, many will you'll help many out by what you're doing, the WOW. Already WOW. Already WOW. Because this helps in an action culture, which is what we're in now. Of course, you go into the stores, all the figures are action figures. In his culture, Southern Indian culture, so hot, blistering hot, sitting quietly is the thing to do. And so just sitting quietly and say, well, you know, where is the I? Or who am I? Yeah, but who? So anything rises, yes, but who am I? Who am I? It's just a blocking technique. It's a blocking technique. That's suitable for, you know, various sensibilities. But sensibilities differ quite a bit. Like in Tibet, when it's so cold for so long, people sit in a cave, they sit quietly around by the fire. So also, they tend to have a certain style. But like here in California, we're active, you know, every moment of every day of our lives, basically. Everybody, I mean, it's a ghost town right now. Why? Everybody's on vacation here. They all flew somewhere, basically. People, I'm going to ask somebody, where are you going to be? Chris, I say, oh, Costa Rica. Yeah, we're going to spend a week in Costa Rica. So there's this area, all these tech people are so wealthy. They're always active. The whole world is very active. So much activity going on now. So the WOW, already WOW. It's already WOW. All this storyline of action figure storyline. Yeah, it's already completely WOWed. That's how the storyline ends, in this total WOW. So all storylines, all quote-unquote lives or storylines, they end just as this perfect total WOW. And in fact, they're already that way. They're already that way. Since they all end that way, we can say they're already that way, actually. Right? In truth, they're already that way. This is how the story ends, in this WOW. And since I'm not interested in having a life anymore, I need to make sure that I see all these options that arise for lives. I just say, I know how it all, that ends exactly the same as all others. So there's no difference. I'm not saying, yeah, this one's better than this. I say, wait a minute, no, that this ends in the WOW. This already is total WOW. This is already total WOW. So this is how you get used to smoothing it all out, being used to it's all smoothed out. Someone asked Ram Maharshi, do you have any disciples? He says, no, I don't have any disciples. I see all of you equally. I see all of you equally, because he knows they all end in this totally smoothed out. All storylines end as this totally smoothed outness, because we all realize that there never was any story about eternal life. There is no story about eternal life. There's no storyline to it. It's all there is. Always. It's all there is. That's not a story. That's just what is. Wow. So be humble enough to not have a life. You can still be breathing and not have a life. You can still be doing but not have a life. Right? You can just be in the wow, the 360-degree wow. So what happens is when you see the nature of mind, true mind, your true nature of mind, it's all smoothed out. If you start saying, okay, well, how can I turn that into a life? What kind of life can I have? Then you lose it. Then you lose it. Okay, now you're back in delusion. But we're so used to thinking in terms of a life that what we do is they say, well, what is my life like when everything's smoothed out? It's 360-degree wow. That's what it is. It's just total wow. Just total wow. Nothing more. Nothing else. Everything is just total wow. That too is total wow. That too is already totally wow. That too is already totally wow. And so you detach from wandering down any of these pathways that we think are lives. You detach from that. So this is the wisdom of meditation. I'm getting clued into it. You know, I'm working on getting clued into it. Just so I'm working on it with Ram Maharshi right now, his pictures. I'm doing a slideshow and I don't want to say whether I'll finish it or not. I don't know. But in working, just trying to do it, I have so much exposure to Ram Maharshi, hours at a time. Every picture, every slide, I have to come up with some caption for the slide. You know, it's like, what do I say to this slide? Where do I put the caption? How do I make it right? You know, and so I'm looking at Ramana. I'm trying to see what is the essential quality of Ramana in this slide, this picture, so I can put something that sort of reflects that. It sort of helps people, eases us. And so I have to tune into Ram Maharshi to do this. So by tuning into Ram Maharshi, I'm getting this tremendous benefit, as I always say. To help yourself, try to help others. So I'm trying to make the slideshow to help everyone else, but in having to focus to make it, I'm getting helped tremendously by this. It's not easy though. At times that my mind is too much and the mind gets overwhelmed and then it starts going negative. It starts spitting out a bunch of negativity and I say, whoa, okay, let's back off for a little while. Do some balance practice. That's panic mode. When you know it's such a big project, it's like, ah. So I just have to back away and say, yeah, okay, let's just wow. Just go back into wowing everything. Everything's already wow. I don't need a life. I'm already totally wowed. I don't need a life to find the wow. I'm already totally wowed. See, we keep thinking this life will lead us to some wow. But I say, yeah, but all lives already are totally wowed. So I don't need to spend time finding the wow. I've already found it. It's already here. It's already totally wowed. All lives are totally wowed. So I don't need to say, what about this one? What about this one? We're all looking at everybody else in the world, aren't we? And thinking, gee, what if I had that life? What if I had that body and that life? See, that body is part of their life path. And I wonder if my life path were like this. Or maybe we joined forces and we would walk down the path of life together. I wonder what that'd be all like. And see, we're lost in that. We're lost in the masquerade. Lost in a masquerade. But the nature of mind is not lost to itself at all. Its presence is completely present. There's nowhere it cannot be present. So those are just vain imaginings we're having. Just say, well, that life would be a total wow. That life, what about that body life? It's already a total wow. This one, you know, it doesn't matter. Some there's this photographer that goes around photographing deformed people and sick people and all this stuff, just showing us the other side of life. And I see it, I say, yeah, I mean, that's already totally wow. Wow, what if I had that life? And to me, That's just as attractive as some, tech magnate, some CEO, some great tech company with a yacht and an island and all that stuff. I mean, that so that's also totally wow. And then some leper begging the streets of Mumbai, that's also totally wow, already totally wow. Because they're looking for a life too in that way. They're saying, maybe I can establish death. Maybe this will help evolve death this way. We flip the script on all these life stories and say, no, it's all already totally wow. 306 degree totally wow. Hope this is recording. Is this recording? Yeah, it is. Good. Okay. That balance work is paying off. I thought it hurt my knee, but it's actually helping it. Interesting. I'm just staying off the trampoline. The trampoline is somewhat, I think really is for younger people. Kids, it's somehow it strains us a little too much. Maybe. I don't know. But it's just psychosomatic. I know that. But I'm going easy on the trampoline. It really puts strain on your body. There's no question about it. I might get back to it at some point, but I'm sort of having to ease back into the fitness thing after this knee just went kablooey. It was on one leg. Like at least one leg was good, so I could still function. So I'm careful about it. I don't want to go overboard. I don't want to try and get a life. Yeah, maybe the news saying, hey, stop trying to have a life. Come on. Because really, trying to have a life is just a clever way of trying to have a death, actually. It's just how we are having a death, trying to have a death. Right? Isn't everything that appears, doesn't it all just die? Or at least it disappears, disintegrates somehow. Pixels on a screen scatter. Has anything really happened to the screen? Is the screen evolving because pixels scatter? People say, like the tech people are so advanced because they see everything as just light and pixels and stuff like that. But what direction are they really going in? And what they really are is they're going towards more and more body consciousness. They say, okay, how can we evolve death more? So you start out with this like electronics, and then you go into more density of death stories. Trying to evolve death in more and more dense ways. So they come here and they get more and more fixated, more and more fixated. They say, oh, I'm making progress. This is great. Because we start, of course, as mind, and it's very difficult for mind to believe in any storylines at all. It's ridiculous. Totally whimsical. So it has to fashion something that to start with, that seems at least plausible to it. So at first, it's this very, diffuse kind of abstract plausibility, and then it gradually becomes less and less abstract, and at some point, it becomes technologically abstract, and then later on, it becomes more just very physically abstract, emotionally abstract, physically abstract, and gets more and more and more dense. So that's how it goes. So that's why in the afterlife, you might see these so-called advanced realms, more abstract realms, but that's actually the effort of mind to evolve death. But it can't just start with the bodies. That's too crazy for it. So it has to start with some very abstract plausibility, and then gradually step it down, step it down, step it down, more and more into more and more concrete storylines, less abstract storylines. That's why when we in the afterlife, we think, oh, we're so advanced now, we're going into subtler realms and all that stuff. But those are just the realms. We've already been there many times, where we regroup and say, okay, gee, I didn't quite reach death yet, so I need to then get centered in this more abstract storyline and then start stepping it down again, and then you find yourself once again in a world with a body. That's just, so you just cycle through it like that. That's why the afterlife is very tricky. You need the Dharma kings to help you out, which Longchenpa promised me he would make sure that I don't get caught up in this delusion. And it's like that. It's like all these tech geeks are like, oh, this solidity is really interesting, you know. Ah, they're like kind of like very, like it's all new to them, sort of. Like they're feeling, They walk kind of weird, they look kind of weird. It's like, oh, you know, being physically robotic, that's really cool. Yeah. Being like a maybe I could be like a dinosaur someday. I hope that I can evolve death to the point of being a dinosaur. I'm working on it. You know, it's like that. Their role models are like dinosaurs. You go into their rooms, these geeks, and they have all these dinosaurs, all reptiles all over the place. You know, it's like, I hope someday I can really be Mr. and Mrs. Death, you know, Mr. Death. Really have a death. Haven't quite reached it yet, though. God, I need a life that'll really give me a death. Come on. I haven't quite reached it yet. I keep cycling. I want to just, you know, finalize. Finally, we got this separate reality, huh? No, never. There's nowhere for that to be. There's only eternal life everywhere. There's only life everywhere. That's all there is. So there's just this wow everywhere, 360-degree wow everywhere. We need that because we're so used to storylines. We have to feel like, well, how did all these storylines, how did this happen? Well, they all just end, this is how it all ended. Just like this, it all came to this great wow. This wow. And since they all end this way, then we can say it's already this way, isn't it? Of course we can say that. There's nothing that doesn't end this way. It's all, so it must already be that way. There's no reason to say, well, maybe I better follow this to see maybe it doesn't end that way. No, it's for sure it ends this. It's wow. Meaning, there's nowhere to wander to. So all this wandering, it all ends up with realizing there's nowhere to wander to. So we've never been wandering at all, actually. If there's nowhere to wander to, have we ever been wandering? Not really. Not really. It's just a presumption. Just a presumption. So, most people let themselves go during the holidays. Here, we don't. We don't. We power through the holidays. We make a great effort to just power through the holidays like this. Because we don't want to lose our momentum and fall back into trying to have a life. So what's our resolution in 2017? Well, I want to make sure that I don't have any life at all. By recognizing that there's no such thing as lives. There's never been. There's never been a single life ever. There's never been a single life. There's never been even one life ever take place. There's only been the one life always taking place. Eternally taking place. There's only been the one life eternally taking place as it is now. So I want a resolution. I want to just, you know, just realize, just wow, already wow. My life is already wow. Actually, all lives are already wow. Because what is our life except constantly trying to find a life, actually? What we call life is just our effort searching for a life. It's our search for a life, actually. And the vehicle of searching dies. We think it dies. But we never really have a life. Nobody has a life. We have a search for a life. But since there are no lives anywhere, isn't the search already over? It's as good as done, isn't it? So wow it right now. Wow. All searches are already ended as total wow. That's also already totally wow. This too is totally wow. This too is totally wow. Don't analyze it. Just do it. This too is already totally wow. As soon as we start analyzing it, we're kind of interested in it, aren't we? Okay. It's already totally wow. Making hand signals here. Which they don't even follow that advice. They say, shh, no, nobody follows advice anymore. They're too desperate to try to find a life. So I don't have any time for advice. I gotta find my life. My advice is don't try to find your life. Just sit here, sit quietly, and wow the fact that all searches are already over. This too is totally wow. Already totally wow. That's totally wow. So I know what it is. So, since I already know what everything is, why not stay with what it is, which is totally wow. 360 degrees in every direction. It's already, and just keep your balance. Keep practicing your balance in that. Don't try to understand it. That's trying to have a life. There's no understanding. There's balance. Keep your balance there. You lose your balance, then you say, why try to understand why did I lose my balance? That also is wow. Get right back into the balance. Don't try to understand why you understand it. Get back to it. When you understand it, then you're fixated. You're trying to fixate a life. Just get back into that too is totally wow. And don't try to engineer the wow. Just whatever arises and tries to pull you into a life, just say, no, that's already, that too is already totally wow. That's totally wow. Wow. So this is real meditation here. This is actual meditation. It's very similar to trying to keep your balance. And I've advised, my whole life I've given advice, and I don't know if anyone's ever followed a bit of advice I've ever given in my life. It's doubtful. I've certainly followed advice from people, and that's why I've I'm able to do what I'm doing now. It's not easy. I mean, we don't want to follow advice. That's how we are. And I should follow it better, actually. If I followed, listened better, I would be better off. People like to look at pictures of gurus and their satsangs or things. What are they doing? What are they doing? Huh, what kind of life can I make out of that? I don't understand it. That's the trouble, isn't it? Pop spirituality doesn't work. Bitter pill to swallow, right? So I got to choose between having a life and not having a life. Can I have both? Yeah, right, both. Now, how can mutual exclusives be both? No, either believe that having a life's possible, or you believe that having a life's not possible. What really means is either believe that having death is possible, or believing that having death is impossible. It's one or the other. Either there's life, eternal life is all there is, or it isn't. See, that's a mutual exclusive. As soon as you say, well, there's a little part of it that's not, then the premise that eternal life is all that is you're saying it's wrong. You're excluding that. It's total exclusion of that. So that's not a compromise. How is total exclusion a compromise? That's absurd. It's an absurdity to say it's a compromise. And that's the start of a storyline, isn't it? Storyline of absurdity. How absurdity conquered reality. How whimsicality became the truth, you know. Well, because it evolved. You know, we evolved absurdity. We evolved whimsicality. All these storylines is the evolution of whimsicality until it becomes the new reality. I just like to hang out, do some swimming, whirlpool, a little stretching, meditating, just like that. What else is there to do? Maybe a little golf occasionally. Just let the attention settle. You know, lose your life. Didn't Jesus say he who will lose his life will gain it? Do you understand what he's saying, talking about now? Yeah. But not just his life. He who would lose all life shall gain eternal life. Didn't he also say that? He who would give up his life for my sake shall have eternal life. Didn't he say that? He certainly did. But we haven't been able to understand what he's talking about. You know. And then finally we understand it. Finally we get it. But it's been a tough road. I mean, they've sabotaged it so badly through the ages that, you know, we just couldn't put it in the right context. I don't know if it's ever been put in the right context. They keep thinking, oh, I got to sacrifice this physical body, and that's the answer. That's got nothing to do with it. That's just grandstanding. That's just trying to evolve death. See, if I evolve death by being crucified, I'll be in heaven, you know, like that. If you had a more abstract layer of storyline, which is just pushing you back into a more concretized, that's not liberation. Liberation is to realize you've never been born. There's nothing to sacrifice because you've never been born. There's nothing's ever been born. How can you have a life that's sacrificed? There's never been a life. So those who keep holding on to this idea of sacrifice, that Jesus was a life that was sacrificed, that's delusion. That's samsaric delusion. That's helping them trying to concretize themselves more and more and more. That's the storyline they need to justify their concretization as a body. That's how they rationalize it. Say, oh no, God wants me to be a body. You know, even sent Jesus here to die to show you, see, life can die. So keep dying, but you need to have a body to die. So we want a concrete, God wants a concretized body now to die. That'll really evolve death, you know. That's the storyline they're using. But you see now Jesus was saying, oh gosh, he who would lose his life for my sake shall gain eternal life. Exactly right. But not just he who would lose his life, but he who would lose all life, all storylines. There's never been any storyline. There's never been any birth. Not just the birth of this body, or birth of this so-called life. There's never been a life. No lives have ever taken place, ever. Not even an insect life. Nothing has ever taken place as far as a life goes. And he who would see it that way shall see there's only eternal life. So Jesus understood that the context that we're in now, with this materialistic action kind of world we're in, required a smoother explanation. Different, you know. So that's why A Course in Miracles, a journey beyond words, and the other voice, and all the material around A Course in Miracles. This was a presentation saying, okay, this is what you need now. Back before the Bible times, he said this is what they needed then, and now these times, this is what you need now. And he didn't try to put A Course in Miracles. He didn't try to really stuff it into the Bible. You know, he referenced it a little bit, but he left it pretty much alone. Actually, he didn't talk about his life back then or anything. It was really a different presentation. But it's possible to smooth it out even more, which is what I've been working on. And Jesus knows that. He's not saying, he told me, don't fixate on A Course in Miracles. I want you to go get through it, you know, get the momentum going, but go. And then, you know, so obviously there's a way to smooth it out even more. Which Ramana already had. Because and there were those who could relate to that, some because the great culture of India, the religious culture of India, had been going on for so long. There were those that could relate to that still. Very, very direct way, Ramana's way. Just do this, you know. You could say, where is the eye? Okay. So your mind starts thinking this way. So where is the eye? I just don't leave that statement, where is the eye? It's just a statement, where is the eye? It's both a statement and a question. Just rest in that, where is the eye? This is a very direct, advanced way. Where is the eye? Meaning, where's the eye of the story line? So don't tell me about the story. Tell me about who's having the story. And of course, in Neo-Vedanta, non-dual teachers, they always say, well, who's asking the question? Who's asking the question? Just focus on who's asking the question. Who wants to have the answer? Who's looking for answers? First, find the one who's looking for answers before we start giving answers. In other words, who's having the life? Find the one who's having the life. This is what Ram would say. Well, where's the eye that's having this life? Find that one. Where's the eye? Where is the eye? Now, don't go searching for it, but just say, just tell the mind, well, where's the eye? Because there is no eye there. There's no one having a life. There's an imaginary wandering that we hope will result in evolving death, which we're trying to call the new life. But who is dying? Rama would say, well, there's no one dying. The body it will dissolve now. The elements will dissolve the body. But there's no one here. There's no one. No one's been born here. There's no life here. Never been any life here. There's nobody dying. You say, I'm going away, but where can I go to? I'm everywhere. I've always been everywhere. There's only one life. Ramana spoke from the standpoint of the one life, the one eternal life. He presented as that. Ramana presented as that. So I'm putting faith in California. It's going to warm up a little bit, and so I can do taping outside more. We went through a period there where it was just, you know, I was too down and too cold and too miserable. So I kind of said, okay, let me just back off until it gets a little better overall. And now I'm back, you know, taping again, which is great. Now, if I had a drone, I could tape all these storylines. Like, I'm just thinking all the different ways I could use it to tape this. But we've already seen a lot of drone footage, haven't we? I certainly have. And you know, I'm already getting used to it. I'm just kind of saying, ah. At first, it's really cool. And then you kind of like, okay. There's sort of similarity to it all. And it's not that cool. It seems like something that after a while will kind of just say, ah, it's not as cool as, it's not a life. I didn't find a life. I didn't find a life. The drone didn't give me a life. Ah, what's next? The foam didn't give me a life. All this foam. Where's my life in the foam? Just let the foam be the foam. It's already totally wow. Everything is already totally wow. So, if you like wide open spaces, vast spaces, if you like foam, just the foam, just like foam, if you, this is a good sign. This is a good sign. This is a good sign. Really good sign that your mind, you're onto it. You're onto it. You're onto it. You're not sure if you want to commit, whether you want to commit to searching for a life or to realize there's no life to search for. We are, there's just the one life. And so you're like, ah, I'm not sure which way I want to go. But if you already have that, that means in previous lives you've already done a lot of work, meditational work. So just keep doing it. Keep doing the work. Yeah, just, well, you say, well, you know, I'll let my, you know, my let grace carry me here. But certainly, if there's comfort in, like pictures of the Himalayas, vast spaces, just like, wow. Or the pictures of the foam, just the play of this abstract play of foam is just, you can just like, ah, I don't need anything else. I don't need a storyline. It's so hard to put a storyline on all this foam moving around, isn't it? Right? It's so hard to put a storyline on the vastness of the Himalayas. You know, it's just the vastness. So, that's a mind that's right there. That's a mind that's right there saying, oh, I'm comfortable with no life. with there's no life anywhere. There's just the one life. That's all there is. Every moment. So there's no need for time. There's no need for the one life to evolve into the one life. There's nowhere for it to evolve to. It's always playing as the one life, right now. So time is needed for trying to evolve death. Space, process, form, all that's an attempt to evolve death. So why do we keep needing to try to evolve death? Except it's just a capricious whim on our, whimsicality on our part, very silly. There's nowhere for death to evolve. There's nowhere for it to evolve. There's no space for it to evolve into. There's no time for it to evolve into. There's no process for it to take place. There's no form for it to take place. There's no form. There's no process. None of that exists. Do pixels on a screen of your computer, these pixels here, is that a form? No, it's just light pixels on a screen. Everything is just light. It's already light. It doesn't have to evolve into light. Boy, I need these 3-day weekends. I really do. I could use 4-day weekends, actually. So, we'll see. As Ramana said, trust, I was saying, Dharma Kings, I need a vacation. I need a staycation. I need a staycation, actually. the stress of my job is killing me. I said, that's no good. You don't want to kill your Dharma prince here. So you don't want to kill a near expert meditator. That's stupid. You know, handle your assets. And I tell the Dharma kings, you know, handle your assets, please. I'm an asset. Maybe I just don't realize or accept that enough. If I did, they would handle it. But I keep saying, oh, what? Me? Because I'm not in any formal institution or anything like that, you know. The Nyingma masters are mostly householders throughout history. They never had any they didn't have much of any organization or any monastic orders at all. So it's just those like myself. It's just some little nobody, you know, hanging out in some little hut that just chopping wood or, you know, carrying garbage. You know, just the garbage man that goes around and collects garbage waste, throws it to the garbage dump. That's, you know, the Nyingma masters, that's what they're all about. It's those who, right in the mundane, humble life, are actually figuring, getting how to meditate and actually meditating. So that is the tradition. So I am part of a tradition, like the tradition of almost no tradition in terms of organization. You know, there's never any head of the Nyingma lineage, really. I think the Galugpas at some point insisted you have to have some head. So they sort of said, okay, you can be the head of it. And they keep changing it here and there. But there's no head of it, really. Not like there's no Dalai Lama of the Nyingmas, actually. It's just little nobodies like myself. You know, little no-lifes like myself. I keep trying to pretend I have a life, though, because everybody expects me to have a life. It's like, I got to pretend I have a life. That's the difficulty, isn't it? Pretending we have a life? Really meaning pretending we have a death. I don't have a death. I always keep telling people, I don't have a death. They say, well, when you die, I say, I don't have a death. I'm not going to die. I don't have a death. There's no death. There's nowhere to die to. There's nothing to die. So I've always told people this, and they always look at me like, you're crazy. You know, you're what? I mean, what are you talking about? So it's a non-dharmic culture I'm in. That would, you know, the dharmic culture would understand that, wouldn't they? They'd say, ah, tell me more about that, no death. Here it's like, boy, you're weird. What do you mean no death? Everybody dies. I say, no, I can't have a death, because who's the I that is dying? There's no I to die. There's no life to die. I don't have a life. I don't have a death. I've never had a death. Nobody's ever had a death. Just try telling people that in a non-dharmic culture, you know. It's just like, cuckoo, 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 cuckoo. Okay. Like, whoa, that's heavy. Wow. I need to go to a rave, man, now, you know, and deal with that one. I need to be avant-garde. You know? I need an avant-garde life to deal with that. Whoa. Let me find an avant-garde life. A hippie life. A hipster life. I said, no. I don't even have a hipster death. I don't even have a hippie death. I don't even have a guru death. Whoa. Big waves, man. Yeah, surf the big waves. Just keep your balance. Work on your balance. Don't go out and try to surf big waves. First, work on your balance. So you're the boss of balance. Be the boss of balance. You don't have to go out surfing to do that. Surfing involves so many other things. You end up not working on your balance very much at all. It's better to be a non-surfer and work on your balance. Be the boss of balance. Maybe someday you'll surf. You get out there, you just say, well, this is easy. What's all the big to do about this? Oh, this is fun. This is easy. This is fun. I enjoy this. I saw Laird Hamilton on his foil board yesterday, a video. It's like, what is he doing? It's like, I cannot even understand there's no way he's it's insane what he's doing. It's unbelievable what he's doing. People don't understand it. I don't understand it. They have to ask him, what go down and see Laird in SoCal and say, what are you doing? I mean, he's like gliding in this lagoon with these real gentle waves, just these swells. They're not even breaking hardly. And he catches it. Then he sees another swell across the lagoon. And somehow he rides his board hydroplaning. He's up above the water over to this other swell. I say, well, where is he getting the energy to do this? I don't understand it. A lot of surfers put him down because they don't understand what supping. He's paddleboarding. He's a stand-up paddler. It's called SUP. He's supping on this hydrofoil. So the board's like a foot and a half off the water. Like he's just gliding in the air. But where's he getting the power? I don't get it. It's like a miracle almost. So anyway, that's something I might look into at some point. Maybe supping. I've never done stand-up paddling. Maybe I'll do that. Maybe I'll be a stand-up paddler. I've never thought of doing that until right this moment. That might be kind of cool, but you need to have really good balance to do that, right? I keep thinking, oh, I might. What if I fall? What if I fall? Well, I guess you get back on your board if you fall. But that hydroplane, what he was doing, and how he was like moving to try to keep it going, there's like, wow. I guess he could use his paddle to get some energy to go over to the other wave. So that's what he's doing. He's combining wave riding with stand-up paddling in a hydroplane way up in the air. That is really very cool, actually, what he's doing. And other people are doing it. There's a few other people that would catch. And you could catch a wave that way. He rides waves, but then he can like go over somewhere to another wave like he's still riding. He's riding the air or something. Like it's so there's a flow to it all. He keeps the flow going with all this balance. You know, it's very amazing. There's just the one life, isn't there? That's sort of reflective of just one life. It never stops. There's nowhere for it to stop. How could it be death? There's nowhere for life to stop. So he's on to something new. He's not, you know, he's just into this. He's already done all this other stuff. He helped invent the golf board. And golf boarding is something new with golf. It's awesome. I want to try that. Really do. I know somewhere I can do that, actually. But, well, yeah. Huh, actually, maybe I could try that. Whoa. So him and the founder of 24 Hour Fitness, Laird Hamilton, the founder of 24 Hour Fitness, not sure who that is, they invented this thing called the golf board. It's like a big skateboard. You put your golf bag on the back of it, and it's like you skate the golf course, like a skateboard, kind of. It's so amazing. And there's actually a golf course near here where they have that. Wow. And you need to get, you know, test it out on, wow, that's an interesting idea. That's something I may point to that. I may do that, actually. Wow. I got a little Christmas bonus. Enough so I could probably play a round of golf there. I haven't played golf in so long. I don't know if I can play it, but I may go out golf a couple times to see if I can do it and then try to get on this golf board. Oh my gosh, that's really amazing, really amazing. You have, I think you have like a throttle, it's electric, you have a throttle, and you ride it like a skateboard, you tip it one way, you tip it the other way, And then you stop. It's really amazing. I could do it. People, I looked at videos of it. I registered my name, so I'm registered to be able to do it. I had to register and agree to all these agreements and stuff that I don't hold them liable. They understand you can't be under toxicants, you know, and all this very stuff. And you make this electronic agreement. So I did that. I registered my name and driver's license number, so I can go to any place now, and I'm in the register to be able to use a golf board. Ooh, wow! Okay, working on my balance to do that. Wow, this is exciting. Holy cow! And maybe I can do some stand-up paddling and use a hydrofoil at some point. It's possible. And there's something very spiritual about this. You know, and we need to be on top of this stuff that's happening in this world, so we don't get carried away with it. We still can meditate, and it doesn't become something that pulls us into a life, you know. People actually can buy a golf board. It's pretty expensive, but you can own a golf board. That's another option too. And it gives you activity instead of driving in a golf court. It goes just as fast as a golf court, if not faster actually. So you can play rounds very quickly with a golf board. But you have all this exercise in riding the golf board, like riding a skateboard through a golf course. So you get this fitness workout at the same time you're playing golf, plus you're playing around in like 2 hours or something, 2.5 hours, or real fast. So it's like, for real active lifestyles of people, faster, faster, faster. This is a trend. I think younger people will get into golf because of the golf board. They can do it. They want to do everything fast. It used to be we wanted to spend 5 hours on the golf course, and we just enjoy the immersion in this place, which I do. I like just to walk, immerse myself in it, and just I just like spending time. I just stop. The Japanese do that, and Asians do that. Golf is an all-day thing. They stop after 9 holes. They have a lunch. They have a massage. They get in the whirlpool, whatever. And then they go back out again, and they spend another 3 hours. So it's like 3 hours in the front nine, 3 hours in the back nine, and like 2 hours for lunch. And there's, you know, an 8-hour day. And they pay a lot for this. It's a whole thing. It's an immersion. It's very Zen-like immersion in this beautiful surroundings, Zen-like surroundings of this golf course. It's, everything's immaculately taken care of. So that's, you know, that's very profound. But you need a lot of money for that. It's how these bigwigs are trying to engineer presence, decompress from that, you know, so they don't die too quickly from that effort. Ah, holy cow. I'm kind of nervous about this. I said, uh-oh, I see some possibilities of doing things. I don't know if I'm ready to do it, so I better start getting a little more active here to do a few things like that. But what's important is do the meditation first. Meditation first, balance work second. So if I can combine golf with balance work, that's very, very profound, actually. So if you have some activity that's really heavily heavy on balance work, that's why I got into skateboarding, but it's a little dangerous, actually. I don't want to hit my knee. I don't want to crash too much. I may get back to it. We'll see. But golf boarding can give you the same, balance, a lot of balance work without the danger, because it's more like a scooter. You're holding on to the handlebars like a scooter. Now you see scooters, all these kids riding these scooters, and it's much more stable. You can't crash it doesn't fall over. Okay, it's got a wide base with wheels, so it's for, you know, people who don't want to crash. You still have this feeling of your balance is being challenged in a lot of ways. And all this stuff. So it's a recreation combining balance work. So have meditation with balance work recreation. That's a good way to realize no life. It's a good lifestyle to recognize no lifestyle. Just eternal lifestyle. Eternal lifestyle. You You see Ramana's mind, it's just smoothed out. It's nothing but smoothness, right? It's totally smoothed out. It always was. Flawlessly smoothed out. He never deviated from that. Eternal life. There's only eternal life. This is interesting. Now, people don't want me to have my life sustained here. They want me to die because they're afraid I might not die. So they're eager to have me die, actually. The whole life, they're very eager to have me die. And it's made it a difficult to be here, for sure. Very difficult. They say, this guy says he's there is no death, he's not going to die, there's no such thing as death. And they said, oh God, we got to make sure he dies, let's help him out. So the way that people help me in the world is they try to help me die. That's true. It's very, very true. So many people have tried to help me die. I say, well, thanks, but not right now. Maybe a little later I'll die, but not right now. So it's... I was the expert in dodgeball when I was young in school. We played dodgeball. I was the champion. I was the best of the best of the best. But everybody's trying to kill me. You know, you throw the ball, you're trying to kill somebody. When you hit them, it's called a kill, and they have to leave. They couldn't hit me. They couldn't hit me. I was always the last one there, pretty much always. I was the very best at it. But that's just continued. Everybody's still trying to kill me. So let me help you die. Let me help you die. I'm an expert at it. They say, well, I'm a real expert at killing people, killing. So I'll help you die. Don't worry. I say, well, thanks, but not yet. Not quite yet. Okay. But hurry up. I might die first, and then I won't be able to help you die. I say, well, yeah, I'm not quite ready to die yet. So it's important that I don't die, so I can keep showing people that, you know, that there is no life to die. There's nothing to die and witness to eternal life here. But people, you know, they don't want that. Say, oh my God. So if you tell them I'm going to witness to eternal life, they say, oh my gosh, I got to really help this guy die. I mean, he's gonna be left behind once we establish death as the new reality. He's not gonna be able to partake of death. You know, that's horrible. He won't be able to have the new life. We gotta get him with the program. Come on. So it's not been a happy experiencing for me here at all, because I'm constantly dodging all this, you know, death that people want to, you know, give me, that the world is doling out to us. And I don't blame the world for it. We're doing it, trying to dole it out to ourselves. Actually, if you tell the world no death, the world will not give you any death. If you tell the world just safety, no trouble, that's the way the world, you'll experience the world that way. It won't harm you in any way. Okay. What time is this getting? Oh, 111, 111. What are we at here? All ones. Just one life. It's just one life. We're starting to see now that all this is starting to become clear. So this is the experience this morning of perfect smoothness, the mind as perfectly smooth. You know, this is, that's what is what it is, right? Yeah. That's what the Dharma kings are pointing to. It's there. One tiny, easy little step is all it takes. Again, this is the truth. I experienced it. I said, let me try this little step. I just did this little adjustment, and instantly, I experienced smooth mind. But totally gentle. It just kind of just, ooh, like smooth foam, it's so smooth, like in slow motion. It was like in super slow motion. Just, oh yeah, my attention just sort of slow motion attention just started looking, and I could see everything. It's just all smooth. Okay, great. Cold. Chilly. I don't know if I should go somewhere, do something, I don't know. Feeling a little better today. After I pass Christmas, my spirits start picking up. Of course, Christmas is the day where we all try to celebrate a life that was born. We say, God sent a life into the world to die, to show us that life can die, you know? And that's the story of Jesus, but that's not really what Jesus was about. God set us an example of no life, of eternal life, showing us that eternal life cannot really die at all. It's all just our imagination. So God sent eternal life into the world to show us that there's only eternal life and nothing else. But they said, well, we want your body to die. He said, well, I'll raise it right up again. It'll just appear again. And it did. So Jesus is the one who showed us that the grave is nothing at all, actually. There is no grave. How can we die if there is no grave, so to speak? Well, we're trying to get around that by quickly. cremate him, quickly, quick. Cremation immediately, you know. There's no cremation ground at all, really. There's no time. I have no time for death. There's no time for death. Eternal life doesn't have any time. It doesn't have time to not be eternal life. There's never any time to not to be non-eternal. There's never any time to be non-eternal. There's never any time to be non-eternal. So now I have to wow this video, don't I? From wow unto wow unto wow. That's my experiencing. I calm down from one wow, and then another one arises. Another wow. This video has been quite an experience to say all this. You know, it's just like, oh my gosh, wow. This too is wow. This too is totally wow. This is already totally wow. That's all that it is. That's all that anything is totally wow. Everything is already totally wowed. Smoothed out wow. Total wow means just, it's smoothly wow. Everything is already totally, total wow means already totally smoothly wow. There's just this smooth wowness to everything already. Just stay in that, and let the future, let it come, whatever you're experiencing is, you know, what comes, let it come. What doesn't come, let it also not come. Will I do this stuff? Will I do this? Will I do that? I don't know. Maybe the idea is there, and if it's not too much wow for me, maybe I will. If it's too much wow, then I won't. It's like that. You know, it's just the stuff that might seem like, I'm not sure I can do that. And at some point later on, you say, oh, yeah, I think that's pretty easy. I can do that. Yeah, it depends on the fitness and the mental state and all this kind of stuff. So I don't worry about that. Let whatever comes come. Just focus on this. Everything is already smoothly, totally wow. Everything is already totally wow. Everything is already totally wow. How are we doing here? Okay, everything is already.